appear. Wait till next year and hope. When your luck is batting zero, get your chin up off the floor. Mister, you can be a hero. You can open any door. There's nothing to it but to do it. You gotta have heart. Miles and miles and miles of heart. Oh, it's fine to be a genius, of course, but keep that old horse before the cart. First, you gotta have heart.
A great slugger we haven't got. A great pitcher we haven't got.
A great ball club we haven't got. What have we got?
We got heart. All you really need is heart. When the odds are saying you'll never win, that's when the grin should start.
Now you're getting the idea.
We got hope. We don't sit around and mope. Not a solitary sod do we heed, mister, 'cause we got hope.
Oh, boys, I'm proud of you.
We're so happy that we're humming.
Hum, hum, hum. That's the hearty thing to do. Hoo, hoo, hoo.
'Cause we know our ship will come in.
Hum, hum, hum.
So it's 10 years overdue.
Hoo, hoo, hoo.
We've got heart, miles and miles and miles of heart. Oh, it's fine to be a genius, of course, but keep that old horse before the cart.
So what the heck's the use of crying? Why should we curse?
We gotta get better,
'cause we can't get worse.
And to add to it, we've got heart.
What do we got?
Heart!
What do we got?
Heart!
What do we got?
We got heart. Miles and miles.
No two words better explain the American Legion Auxiliary's reason for being. In essence, we continue to do what we do for over 100 years because we care deep down within each of our hearts, caring for our nation, caring for our communities, caring for our children, caring for our military service members, caring for our veterans, caring for each other and ourselves, and caring for caregivers. Over the next 3 days, we'll explore, recognize, and celebrate the many ways we truly care. Here to open the 2022 American Legion Auxiliary National Convention. From the Department of Kentucky is our national president, Kathy Dodestal.
Good morning. Welcome to Caring Hearts, the 101st American Legion Auxiliary's National Convention. I am so excited to share with each of you an outstanding convention experience. As noted in the video, over the next 3 days, we'll explore, recognize, and celebrate the many ways the American Legion Auxiliary truly cares. And of course, you know my emphasis this year is caring for those who care for others. Meeting these hidden heroes face to face, listening to their stories and experiences, has changed me profoundly. One such story that's dear to my heart is the caregiver journey of Georgette Winton and her husband Jason, a Desert Storm veteran who served in Iraq. Let's take a look.
In the beautiful Pocono Mountains in northeastern Pennsylvania, you'll find the home of Jason and Georgette Winton. Both are American Legion family members at Unit and Post 927 in Gilbert, Pennsylvania. Jason served in Desert Storm in Iraq as a combat engineer.
As a combat engineer, I did explosives, minefields, and tank obstacles.
So one night after blowing up God knows what, Jason developed a rash. He went to the medic and they misdiagnosed it as heat rash. They told him, just keep it dry, put powder on it, you'll be fine. 7 years later, he wound up getting the correct diagnosis of inversion psoriasis. After years of not being treated, it led to gout, which in turn, he was allergic to all of the medicines. So the only thing he could take was prednisone. Prednisone on its own caused a myriad of problems, including bone loss, which caused both of his feet to break within a week of each other.
That's when Georgette's role as a caregiver really ramped up.
In addition to his physical disabilities, Jason also suffers from service-connected PTSD and major depressive disorder.
The VA sent Jason to a foot specialist, but his feet were in such bad shape that not much could be done.
Unfortunately, we had discussed taking both of my legs, and then it ended up being just my left leg at first, and I said, no, doc, we're going to do both at the same time.
That's when Georgette left her full-time job to be Jason's full-time caregiver. Unfortunately, Jason's condition worsened.
In May of 2020, Jason developed an infection in his left stump. It required surgery and IV antibiotics. And that led to one of the worst days of my caregiving journey. Because of COVID, I wasn't allowed to be with Jason. I wasn't allowed to be there with him as he faced surgery. I wasn't allowed to be there to comfort him. But it really prevented me from knowing what I needed to know when Jason came home. Being left in the dark left me scared and anxious. I spent the entire day in tears worrying about if I would actually be able to do what needed to be done when Jason finally came home. That experience taught me to work through the hardships that come along with caregiving. I had to learn to deal with misplaced guilt. Guilt should be reserved for when I've done something wrong to someone else. I shouldn't feel guilty for taking care of myself.
On top of everything, Georgette is dealing with her own health issues.
In October 2021, I was diagnosed with ovarian cancer. My first round of chemotherapy didn't work, so I'm currently undergoing a second round of chemotherapy to try to get the cancer under control.
At that point, Georgette sought out other caregivers for support and guidance.
The first time I met other caregivers was during an event sponsored by the Caregiver Support Program at the VA. It was then that I realized that I wasn't alone.
Then, Georgette was introduced to Patriots Cove in Pennsylvania.
Patriots Cove is a retreat that allows veterans healing through nature and fly fishing, while caregivers are given the time for respite, education, and self-care.
I've been fly fishing for half of my life, and being able to go out in a wheelchair and fly fish again was one of the greatest experiences I had in a long time. And with the guys that are in similar circumstances as I am around me, to enjoy it was fantastic.
Jason depends on and appreciates everything Georgette does for him.
Without my wife Georgette being by my side, I couldn't do three quarters of the things that I do. She's my rock, she's my life, my love, she does everything.
While caring for Jason, Georgette continued to find ways to help other caregivers like herself.
Then I became involved with the Elizabeth Dole Foundation, whose mission is to advocate for military and veteran caregivers. In 2021, I was named a Dole Caregiver Fellow representing the state of Pennsylvania. It allows me to be a voice for caregivers whose voices aren't strong enough yet.
Georgette has a message for all fellow auxiliary members.
Most caregivers live in the shadows, and that's why we're called hidden heroes. But you can make a difference. Offer to cook a meal, run an errand, or mow the lawn. Get to know the caregivers in your community and your unit. Ask questions. A small act of kindness can mean so much.
Wasn't that awesome? Though my year is almost over, I hope you all find a place in your heart to continue to care for our caregivers. As Georgette said, a small act of kindness can mean so much. Thank you so much for sharing your story, Georgette. Well, I think there is no better way to kick off our convention than with some music. Incorporating rock with his southern roots, Billy Brown brings his very own flavor to country music. From ballads to boot stomping anthems, his music breaks the genre barrier and appeals to anyone who loves some good old tunes. Based out of Cincinnati, Ohio, Northern Kentucky, Billy Brown travels around the country bringing his style of country music to the masses. Please give a warm auxiliary welcome to the Billy Brown Band.
What's up, y'all? Woo! My name's Billy Brown. Right here on this guitar, Jeff Ray. We're singing y'all a few songs this morning. Down windows and a long neck bottle, that's a killing time. It's a no time feeling, get to start to believe in what yours is mine. And when we lay down,
up in the moonlight, I know we're living right. You got the blood and green eyes shining in the middle of a country night. Got a real good country song, feeling good, I'm breaking away from home. Sing along, girl, leave the world behind. Now write your name in the sky, and the stars are shining bright in the middle of a country night. Track holding hands for the first time.
Hands for the first time.
I was shaking, leaning in for a kiss in the middle of a country night. And we were dancing in the moonlight, and no, we didn't do it right. We were young, but we fell in love in the middle of a country night. Got a real good country song, feeling good, I'm making a way of life. Sing along, gonna leave the world behind. Now write your name in the sky, and the stars are shining bright in the middle of a country night. Country song, feeling good, I'm breaking away from your
life.
Turn the radio up, sing along, girl, leave the world behind. Woo! Got a real good country song, feeling good, I'm breaking away from your
life.
Turn the radio up, sing along, girl, leave the world behind. Now write your name in the sky, and the stars are shining bright in the middle of a country night.
Woo! Thank you. This next song that I wrote several years ago, it's started out as a love song, and it became quickly more than that. You know, our society says that you gotta look a certain way, you gotta have a certain body type and hair color to be beautiful, but we believe that God made you beautiful just the way you are. So this song is called Natural, and I hope y'all like it. Beautiful, just the way you are. Every morning when I wake up lately, I thank God there's an angel in my arms. You should pull that hair back, baby, and smile that little smile. It's who you are. You should know you're my inspiration for the words to the song that's in my heart. You will be my melody. Everyone will sing along. You're natural, being a natural. You're a little country girl, a shooting star. And you're beautiful,
you're so beautiful, you know you are. Not sure. Bright lights, baby, the moon's the only light we'll ever need. Every evening when we lay down lately, it feels like I'm living in a dream. And you're beautiful,
beautiful,
oh so beautiful, you know you are. Not true. Just the way you are.
Thank you. It is such an honor to be here singing some music for you all. I appreciate y'all so much. My dad was in Vietnam, my uncles were there, and we don't take our freedom for granted, so thank you guys so much. It is an honor to be here singing some songs for y'all. Here's another one of my original songs called She's My Girl. Hope y'all like it.
Cause when she sways like that, tips that long neck back, yeah, I go, whoa-oh, whoa-oh. With those cut-off jeans and those ripped-up seams, yeah, I go, whoa-oh, whoa-oh. She makes my heart beat harder. She makes these cool nights harder, yeah. She's my sweet tea, sipping spike with lemon berry shine. She's my wild night, dipping in the river by the pine. She's my whole world. She's my piece of heaven on earth. She's my girl. She's my girl. Cause when she drives my truck, turns her radio up, yeah, I go, whoa-oh, whoa-oh. With that long blonde hair blowing everywhere, yeah, I go, whoa-oh, whoa-oh. She makes my heart beat harder. She makes these cool nights harder, yeah. She's my sweet tea, sipping spike with lemon berry shine. She's my wild night, dipping in the river by the pine. She's my whole world. She's my piece of heaven on earth. She's my girl. She's my girl. She don't know what she does, but I can't get enough. She's my sweet tea, sipping spike with lemon berry shine. She's my wild night, dipping in the by the punch. She's my, my whole world. She's my piece of heaven on earth. She's my girl. She's my girl. My girl. My girl.
Thank you so much. Love y'all.
All right, let's give one more big thank you. And there should be an announcement coming soon. Or not. Ladies and gentlemen, the 101st American Legion Auxiliary National Convention will resume shortly as we reset the stage and prepare for our business meeting. We'll be right back.
We'll resume shortly after we reset the stage and prepare for our business meeting.
New York is everything they say, and no place that I'd rather be.
back to Caring Hearts, the 2022 American Legion Auxiliary National Convention. Here to begin our business meeting is your national president, Kathy Dottestall.
You can't break, you can't break an American heart. An American heart. An American heart.
Welcome back to Caring Hearts, the 2002 American Legion Auxiliary National Convention. Good morning, delegates and guests. Good morning.
Good morning.
Much better. The 101st National Convention of the American Legion Auxiliary will now come to order. But you may as well. Before we begin our opening ceremonies, I would like everyone to please ensure your electronic devices have been placed on silent mode. National President's pages, please post the colors. Two. Our national chaplain, Carol T. Robinson, will now lead us in prayer.
Good morning. As we go in prayer this morning, each in our own faith, let us remember how those four chaplains of different faith on the Dorchester came together, locked arms, and prayed. Almighty God, creator of all that has been, that is, and is still to come, be with us as we come together as members and friends of the American Legion Auxiliary. Bless and guide President Kathy as she conducts this convention, and thank you so much for bringing her safely back to us. Let us listen and learn from the reports given by the chairman that we may take away ideas to further our commitment to our veterans, our active duty military, and communities. Be with our servicemen and women. Keep them in your care. All these blessings we ask in your name, and before we say amen, may we stand in a moment of silence. Amen.
Please remain standing as Norma Tram, National Americanism Chairman, leads us in the Pledge of Allegiance, followed by the singing of our national anthem, led by Billy Brown, and finally the reciting of our preamble, led by National Constitution and Bylaws Chairman Pam Ray. Norma?
With nothing in your hands, please join me. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
The dawn's early light, what so proudly we hail at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, worses gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star
for God and country?
We associate ourselves together for the following purposes: to uphold and defend the Constitution of the United States of America, to maintain law and order, to foster and perpetuate a 100% Americanism, to preserve the memories and incidents of our association during all wars, to inculcate a sense of individual obligation to the community, to combat the autocracy of both the classes and the masses, to make right the master of might, to promote peace and goodwill on earth, to safeguard and transmit to posterity the principles of justice, freedom, and democracy, to participate in and contribute to the accomplishment of the aims and purposes of the American Legion, to consecrate and sanctify our association by our devotion to mutual helpfulness.
You guys can stay up, we're gonna introduce you.
It is my honor this morning to present the 2021-2022 National Officers of the American Legion Auxiliary. National Historian Carol Campbell of Virginia. National Chaplain Carol T. Robinson of Ohio. Central Division National Vice President Denise Delaney Rowland. Eastern Division National Vice President Marie Picka of Rhode Island. Northwestern Division National Vice President Dee Dee Buckley of Minnesota. Dee Dee is unable to be with us this week, so I'd like to ask that you keep her in your prayers. Southern Division National Vice President Gabriel Barnett of Georgia. Western Division National Vice President Tony Gimbel of Idaho. National Secretary Coral May Grout of Massachusetts. National Treasurer Mary Beth Revoir of Illinois. And my national president and yours, Vicki Kautz of Indiana. And please welcome our special guests, National Headquarters Interim Executive Director Sarah Regal and our professional parliamentarian Chris Dickey. And of course, I would like to introduce you to my amazing pages. Karen Toll from Kentucky. Well, they're all from Kentucky. Karen Toll. Doug McGuire. Elisa Boozer. Anne Marie Schaus. They are amazing. Well, it's so hard to believe that it's been a year since I stood on a stage just like this and was installed as your 101st national president. Honestly, while I was traveling and sitting in my 7th airport of the week, my installation felt like a lifetime ago. But right now, it feels like I blinked and the entire year just flew by. It's definitely been one heck of a ride. In fact, my year was a lot like a ride that I was just on. Many of you know I came into convention riding my own motorcycle with the riders for the entire legacy run. There were some incredibly long stretches, rough terrain, endless nights in different hotels, lots of rain. So yeah, pretty much like my ride as national president. But you know what was also the same? The views were beautiful. The people were amazing. And this has definitely, most definitely been the experience of a lifetime to travel through the great nation and meet all of you. So looking back, my ride into national convention is a perfect metaphor for my ride as national president. Truly an experience I will never forget. Thank you. As I worked with my team on planning this national convention, we focused on finding ways to share all the experiences that I've had in the past year. We decided the best way to share these experiences was through the stories of all the amazing, caring hearts I met along the way. I met so many people living our mission every day and working to change the world, one relationship at a time. These caring hearts deserve to have their stories told and celebrated. So during this convention, we'll tell their stories, and together we'll celebrate and honor all of the caring hearts right here in the American Legion Auxiliary. Let's start by welcoming some very special guests to the stage. Please welcome Wisconsin Department President Diane Wagon.
I'm from Wisconsin, and I believe that life is for living, and I'm Madam National President, national officers, delegates, alternates, and guests. On behalf of the 17,000 auxiliary members of the Department of Wisconsin, we welcome you to our beautiful state. The state of Wisconsin last hosted the National Convention in 2010. And it's so nice to see so many familiar faces. And we really look forward to meeting and making many new friends through your stay here. The members of our Department of Wisconsin, and especially the Milwaukee community, would like to extend our friendly hospitality to everyone. We want you to have fun. Perhaps you've heard the Packers, beer, and cheese are big in Wisconsin. But did you know Wisconsin is the largest producer of cranberries in our nation? And the United States is the largest producer of cranberries in the world. So besides beer, cheese, and cranberries, there are other great things to see, do, and eat while you are here. Take time to explore Milwaukee's beautiful on the lakefront. Feel the heat of the desert oasis or the humidity of a tropical jungle and experience the bright colors of a floral garden, all at one destination, the Mitchell Park Domes. Shop for gifts and sample great specialty foods at the Milwaukee Public Market. The Milwaukee Art Museum boasts an extensive collection of nearly 20,000 works representing such artists as Pablo Picasso, George O'Keefe, and Andy Warhol. Make sure you experience Discover World, Milwaukee's premier science and technology center for the entire family. Tour the opulent Pabst Mansion, featuring 37 rooms, 12 baths, and 14 fireplaces, located on the historic Grand Avenue. The Riverwalk also is a beautiful way to explore Milwaukee. All these that I have just mentioned are within 3 miles of this convention center. 7 miles straight west is the Milwaukee County Zoo. 6 miles to the north, you can play a round of disc golf. No matter your interests, we have something for you. Thank you for coming, for joining us here in Wisconsin. We want you to be safe, have fun, and learn much. Truly enjoy this, your convention.
And now, please welcome our National Convention Chairman, Amy Luft.
Madam National President Kathy, dignitaries, members, and guests, on behalf of the Department of Wisconsin, welcome to Brew City, Milwaukee. We are honored to host this year's National Convention in America's Dairyland and the cheese capital of the world. We have many fun things planned for you over the next few days, but first, a little bit about this great state of Wisconsin. Outside of these city walls, you will find that the state of Wisconsin is mostly rural. It was actually the Native Americans who were our first settlers, and across our state, many of our community names reflect their heritage. Chippewa Falls, Oshkosh, Menominee, Oconomowoc, Wauwatosa, Ashwaubenon. Try to say that name after a few beers. Hey, did you know that Wisconsin is the number one producer of cheese in the United States? We have more cheese factories here than any other state. Make sure to try our world-famous cheese curds while you're here. Fresh, fried, or marinated, just about every restaurant you go to will have them on the menu. We enjoy two seasons here in Wisconsin, winter and construction season. Seriously, we're blessed to enjoy all four seasons. We have many beautiful lakes throughout our state that offer great fishing in the spring. Our summers are great for swimming, boating, and camping at our state parks. And Wisconsin's fall colors are spectacular, which offer great hiking opportunities. And then there's winter. Our average temperature is about 7 degrees, and our average snowfall is about 48 inches a year. But we don't hibernate during that time. All that snow is perfect for skiing and snowmobiling, which is very popular in our northern areas. We are fortunate to be the home of three major league sports franchises. The Milwaukee Bucks recently brought home their second NBA championship in 2021. We're also the home of the Milwaukee Brewers, and you can catch a game tonight. And the four-time Super Bowl winners, the Green Bay Packers. The famous Lambeau Field, also known as the Frozen Tundra, is just 2 hours north of Milwaukee. They offer tours, they have great restaurants, and a fun pro shop so you can grab all your cheesehead gear. Oh, and we can't forget about our famous college football team, the Wisconsin Badgers. Go Bucky! The city of Milwaukee is located on the beautiful shores of Lake Michigan, just 90 minutes north of Chicago, and is one of the most diversified cities in the entire United States. Hey, here's a fun fact for you. Milwaukee is known as Cream City for its historical building construction. As you walk throughout our streets, you'll notice that the buildings are made with cream color brick. Now, getting around our city is super easy, and as we have plenty of public transportation and our own streetcar called the Hop. You'll also find that Milwaukee is one of the most walkable cities around. Milwaukee's crown jewel is the fact that we are home to Harley-Davidson Motorcycle. Hey, not only do us Wisconsinites love to ride our Harleys, but we love to show them off at the Harley-Davidson Museum. Make sure to check it out before you leave. But there's one industry over the past 175 years that has thrived in this city more than any other, the beer industry. Given the nickname Brew City, some of the most iconic breweries over the years have included Schlitz, Blatt's, Pabst, and Miller. Currently, there are over 300 breweries in our state. Many of them offer tours, which conclude with a free glass or two of beer. A fun one for you to check out is the Lakefront Brewery, where you'll see the iconic assembly line with the glove on the beer bottle from the Laverne and Shirley show. Speaking of, Happy Days made Milwaukee America's hometown. You can say "ay" to the Fonz, the Bronze Fonz, which is located on Milwaukee's Riverwalk, just south of Wells Street. The Bronze Fonz is a must-visit selfie spot. The Riverwalk will bring you to the doorstep of our city's best restaurants, brew pubs, and shops. It takes many volunteers to put on a convention like this size. I am blessed to work with the best of the best, and I'd like to introduce you to my dedicated team. Please hold your applause until the end. Vice Chairman Maggie Geiger, Local Page Chairman Sandy Mack and her co-chair Shirley Creer, Flowers and Corsage Chairman Linda Koska and co-chairman Darcy Koska. Mailroom chairman Christine Johnson and her co-chair Morgan Johnson. National President's driver Donna Johnson. Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to introduce to you the Cheese Dream Team. Now, I asked them to model something, some special apparel for you. Our local pages will be very noticeable as they sport these one-of-a-kind cheese scarves. The local pages and all of us are here to assist you with anything that you may need while you stay here in Milwaukee. Our home is your home, so please allow us to care for you. And please make sure to stop in at our office at room 201C. We have a photo booth with lots of Wisconsin props, including cheese heads, so you can create your own memories from convention. Every time you stop in by us, you can put your name in for a drawing. We'll be having fun giveaways each day. All Wisconsin theme, of course, so make sure to stop in and say hi. And a fun extra bonus. We had a delivery this morning of fresh cheese curds. So stop in while they're still squeaky and get your free sample. Madam National President Kathy, thank you very much for trusting me as your National Convention Chairman. I very much appreciate this opportunity. The Cheese Dream Team would like to present you with a special present. Have a great time in Milwaukee, everyone. Enjoy the conference.
Edible kind is my favorite. Finally, please welcome past National President Nicole Clapp.
National President Kathy, on behalf of the past national presidents, I would like to welcome everyone to the 101st National Convention here in Milwaukee. President Kathy, we congratulate you on a most successful year leading the ALA. You encouraged us to care for those who care for others. Now, the time has come to celebrate the accomplishments during this past year. Everyone, how many are attending your first national convention? There's a few in the crowd. Welcome. Attending a national convention offers opportunities to gain knowledge about our organization and new initiatives while having fun getting reacquainted with old friends and meeting new members from all over the world, including a few cheeseheads. American Legion family, it is time to now pause, because most importantly, to reflect upon why we are each members of this wonderful organization, honoring our veterans, military, and their families. And President Kathy, you know, I am very proud of you, and our friendship has grown over the last several years. So everyone, do President Kathy proud by enjoying this year's convention as we make memories to cherish our caring hearts. Enjoy, everyone. Welcome to Milwaukee.
Thank you, Nicole. All right. We will again be utilizing the electronic voting system. Woohoo! Your delegation chairman should have already picked up your voting keypads before today's session began, and each delegate should have a keypad. Remember that convention standing rule number 16 states that voting keypads are not to be removed from the assembly hall, and each department's delegation chairman is responsible for all keypads issued to their department. Departments will be charged a $150 donation to the ALA Foundation Mission Endowment Fund for each missing keypad. So be sure to count them before you turn them into the election committee at the end of the day. We will be using the number one key for a yes vote, the number two key for a no vote, and I will remind you again, if you choose to abstain from voting, simply do not press any keys. Now, if you press the wrong key on the keypad, wait a moment and then press the correct number. The keypad will register only the last key pressed. So get your keypads out. Let's practice. If this is your first time attending a national convention, press the number one key now. If it is not your first time, press the number two key. And we'll give you a few minutes. Are we ready for the results? No? Okay, thank you. All right, the results are... Fantastic, 15% of you are brand new. So thank you for joining us today. All right, now that you all have this keypad thing under control, let's play a game. JP, hit it.
Welcome to Auxiliary Feud, the game that pits American Legion Auxiliary members against members in a contest of AOA history and trivia. Please get out your keypads and get ready to play Auxiliary Feud. Please welcome your host, our national president, and Kentucky's finest, Cappy D.
Okay, it's time to play ALA Family Feud. We'll try to play a little ALA Family Feud every day, and each time we will play using our voting keypads. So get ready. Question number one. When was the last time we were in Milwaukee for the national convention? A, 2007, B, 2010, C, 2011. Please answer now using your voting keypad. And the survey says... Woo! Okay, so 558 of you think the last time we were here was in 2010. And you are right. The last time Milwaukee hosted our national convention was also the year I went out as department president. So it's come full circle. Great job. All right, question number two. How many states make up the ALA's Western Division? The Western Division better get this right. A5, B8, or C10? Please answer now using your voting keypads. And the survey says... Ooh. So... I can't figure it out. 301 of you think there are 8 states in the Western Division. And you would all be wrong. Yeah, I know, I was wrong. The correct answer is C. 308 of you got it right. 10 states in the Western Division. All right, it's time for the final question. Are you ready? This word in the preamble to the ALA Constitution means to instill or ingrain. A, autocracy. B, sanctify. Or C, inculcate. Please answer now using your keypads. And the survey says, C, inculcate. 539 of you got it correct. Awesome job, everyone. Are you ready to be official keypad users? All right, let's keep the fun going with our first item of business, which is the adoption of the reports which organize the convention. The credentials report will be presented by Credentials Chairman Donna Dillard, Department of Texas.
Good morning. Madam National President, the Credentials Committee met on Saturday, August 27, 2022, and the following is our report. Delegates by state: Alabama, 9. Alaska, 8. Arizona, 16. Arkansas, 7. California, 19. Colorado, 9. Connecticut, 9. Delaware, 8. District of Columbia, 6. Florida, 33. Georgia, 11. Hawaii, 6. Idaho, 8. Illinois, 22. Indiana, 34. Iowa, 19. Kansas, 12. Kentucky, 11. Louisiana, 9. Maine, 10. Maryland, 20. Massachusetts, 11. Michigan, 24. Minnesota, 25. Mississippi, 9. Missouri, 12. Montana, 8. Nebraska, 18. Nevada, 6. New Hampshire, 12. New Jersey, 12. New Mexico, 9. New York, 30. North Carolina, 11. North Dakota, 11. Ohio, 31. Oklahoma, 8. Oregon, 10. Pennsylvania, 44. Puerto Rico, 6. Rhode Island, 7. South Carolina, 9. South Dakota, 12. Tennessee, 8. Texas, 17. Utah, 7. Vermont, 10. Virginia, 12. Washington, 11. West Virginia, 9. Wisconsin, 20. Wyoming, 8. For a total of 713 delegates. Madam President, on behalf of the Credentials Committee, I move that the roll of delegates hereby submitted be the official voting attendance for this convention.
The question is on the adoption of the Credentials Committee's report as presented. Is there any discussion? The question is on the motion to adopt the report of the Credentials Committee. All those in favor, press the number one key on your voting pad. Those opposed, press number two. Please vote now. Voting is now closed. Please show the results. 661 in favor and 5 opposed. There is a majority in the affirmative. The motion is carried and the credentials report for the 2022 National Convention has been adopted. Thank you, Donna. Rules Chairman Judy Lynch will present the proposed rules for this convention.
The rules are printed in pages 24 and 25 of the Legion Family Program. Madam National President Kathy, by the direction of the Rules Committee, I move the adoption of the National Convention rules for 2022 as printed.
The question is on the adoption of the National Convention rules for 2022 as printed. Is there any discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please press the number one keypad on your voting pad. Those opposed, please press number two. Vote now. Please show the results. Voting is closed. I never said that before. I gotta look back. 650 in favor, 9 opposed. There being 2/3 in the affirmative, the motion is carried and the rules for the 2022 National Convention have been adopted. Thank you, Judy.
You're welcome. Dear. I love you.
National Secretary Coral May Grout will now give the convention report.
Good morning. Please refer to the agenda that was distributed to all delegation secretaries during registration. The delegation secretaries were charged with distributing this agenda to their delegates and alternates. I move the adoption of the agenda as printed.
Is there a second? All right, motion is seconded. The question is on the motion to adopt the program as printed. Are you ready for the question? Thank you. Somebody talk to me. Thank you. The question is on the motion to adopt the program as printed. All those in favor, press number one on your keypad. Those opposed, press number two. Please vote now. Voting is now closed. Please show the results. Six 661 in favor, 11 opposed. The affirmative has it, and the convention agenda is adopted.
Perfect.
Thank you, Cora. You're welcome. By adoption of these reports, the 101st National Convention of the American Legion Auxiliary is officially organized for conducting business. We can learn a lot from our juniors. After all, they are our future leaders. During this term, the ALA juniors were very busy. Here to tell us more about it is National Junior Activities Chairman, Deb Albers. Our juniors are heart and soul. National President Kathy chose caregivers as her national focus during this past year. The caregiver patch for juniors was created for blue level juniors in high school. Requirements for the patch included writing an essay about caregiver support, completing 5 related activities to caregiving, putting together a caregiver survival kit or first aid kit, and when the requirements for the patch were completed, junior members have a good grasp of what it takes to be a caregiver. Many juniors' hearts went out to caregivers. There hadn't been a face-to-face national meeting since early 2020. In the summer of 2021, juniors met in a virtual junior jamboree. But in 2022, we returned to face-to-face meetings. Meetings were advertised and division chairmen became involved and contacted department chairmen. On January 29th, 14 juniors attended the meeting in Las Vegas for the Western Division. It was a fun time, and National President Kathy was there to greet the juniors and share ice cream. 13 juniors attended the National Junior Meeting in Orlando. And National President Vicki Kautz was there also to share ice cream. Central Division juniors met at National Headquarters in Indianapolis. National President Kathy was there in spirit in their group photo with 18 attending. As momentum grew, the Baltimore meeting had 43 participants. So many that, in fact, registration had to close due to the space available. Amazing. Last but not least, on April 2nd, the meeting in Omaha met at Post 1 with 19 juniors. Lots of activities kept junior members engaged at the national meetings, from icebreakers to get to know each other, and decorating and filling caregiver bags. These bags were distributed to VA medical centers and to be given to caregivers. Each one included a phone charger, notepad, pen, and hand sanitizer. And games for fun were enjoyed by all. Little Sally Walker, from coast to coast, and Baby Shark were, of course, the favorites. The girls had fun sharing names and well wishes in autograph books. We performed the 13 folds of the flag, and each of the participants practiced folding the flag. Open win cards were made and dispersed at veterans' homes. These were created with heart and soul. Various awards were given to juniors. Members of Blue Star families were given pins. And in keeping with National President Kathy's caregiver awareness,
Youth caregiver certificates were awarded to junior members that helped provide care to family members. Now, the youngest juniors at the red level earned Poppy, American, and Leadership patches. In Baltimore, two good deeds were given to deserving juniors. The military children's table ceremony was performed at the end of every meeting. Each of these meetings were a whirlwind of activities and heart and soul. I feel so privileged to have been a part of it. Juniors have heart and soul. And now I get to announce our 2022-2023 Honorary National Junior Divisional Vice Presidents. From the Central Division, Hayden Freeman of Illinois. From the Eastern Division, Mackenzie McDaniels of New York. Northwestern Division, Samantha Stye from Minnesota. Southern Division, Jasmine Harris from Florida. Western Division, Audrina Rosales from Arizona. Speaking of heart and soul, you are about to meet our Junior Member of the Year, Ava Groth, of Unit 781, Mountaintop, Pennsylvania. Ava's nomination was made by her father, Ed Groth, who is an auxiliary member. And in addition to several projects she's been involved with, she organized a project she dubbed Mission Restoring Memories. She was able to assemble 55 volunteers and collect over $2,000 from donations for chemicals to clean and restore over 200 headstones at the cemetery in Mountaintop, Pennsylvania. Give a warm welcome to Ava Groth, 2022 Member of the Year.
National President, Chair Members, fellow Auxiliary Members, good morning. I'll start off by saying what an honor it is to receive this award. I don't think it's truly even hit me yet, even as I stand on the stage in front of you, that this is like a national level award, one that people from all over our country picked me to receive. But it truly is such an honor. A lot of sweat and work went into projects I did as a junior, but I wouldn't change any of it. The reward of being proud of all I've accomplished is all I could have asked for. I think every eligible girl should be a junior. When I first started, I went to my state junior convention that year, 2017. There were so many girls, and many of which who I still talk to this day. And the project they had at that convention, which was supply backpacks for homeless veterans, inspired me that same fall with my own backpack drive, one that went out to the children of active service members who wouldn't have otherwise gotten back to school supplies. But that's why I think young girls should get involved. I think many times we look at other projects and say, well, that's already been done, or my project won't make as much of an impact. But that's really not true. Every single project helps, and me standing before you today is proof of that. But my time as a junior hasn't all been by myself. And I think that's the most wonderful part of the American Legion as a whole. No matter what project I took on or what I wanted to do, my Legion family was always there to support me. I remember when I was working with Pennsylvania past president Lisa Boyer and her project of helping Pennsylvania Warhorse, a program to help veterans with PTSD. I needed help and I turned to the juniors in my state, and a bunch of us showed up for a day at the farm with tons of donations and to spend the day with the horses. With the support of Pennsylvania past president Pat Carnes, my term as Pennsylvania junior president was a success. She helped me get in contact with several people who helped me tremendously while I was Pennsylvania junior president. My role in the auxiliary also helped me get more into Girl State, a program that I cannot praise enough. When I went to Girl State in 2021, that year, Pennsylvania was virtual. But because of my involvement in the junior auxiliary, I was invited back the next year as a junior counselor. Over those 2 years, I have become so close with the girls in charge of that program, and I can see the passion for all that they do, and I cannot thank them enough for their involvement. Being a junior is such a huge part of my life. It has helped me become more outgoing, more aware of what it means to be a member of this beautiful country, and it's helped me create amazing connections. From the day I started to the day where I stand in front of you, I have loved the American Legion Junior Auxiliary, and I cannot wait to continue in this amazing American Legion family as an American Legion Auxiliary member.
Thank you for your report, Deb. And isn't Ava amazing? The American Legion Auxiliary Girls State Program focuses on making grassroots connections and forging relationship with the communities to increase membership as well as awareness. Let's welcome ALA Girls State and Girls Nation Chairman Nancy McGinnis for more information.
Madam President, good morning. Raise your voices, raise them high. Sing to Girl State, and here's why. Look to Girl State, and you'll find tomorrow's leaders of mankind. Throughout this summer, those words rang out loud and clear across the nation as young women sang them while participating in an American Legion Auxiliary Girl State program. When I hear those words, my heart tends to skip a beat, knowing the impact the ALA is having on today's youth. While the past 2 years COVID tried to flatline our program, the Department ALA Girl State teams throughout thought out of the box to make sure we didn't lose our premier youth program. The heart of the matter in 2022 is we had 49 departments having ALA Girl State sessions, with four totally virtual, and some held in conjunction with the American Legion's Boys State. Programs returning to in-person sessions continue to implement and use technology processes they use during virtual sessions to further enhance their in-person experiences. Several Department Girl State programs build service projects into their sessions that tie into the ALA mission in a variety of ways. The Department of Missouri ALA challenged their delegates to bring non-perishable food items for the USO at the St. Louis Lambert Airport. A truckload of crackers, cookies, moon pies, and more, along with cash donations. The ALA Missouri Girl State left a heartfelt contribution to the USO. Patty Pink, who is an ALA Girl State and Girls Nation alum, as well as an ALA member and Missouri ALA Girl State counselor, stated when she stepped into the USO, her horizon was broadened about how the USO was a home away from home for military personnel. The Department of Arkansas, ALA Girl State, thinks of service in a different way. Their units encourage sponsoring delegates to give volunteer hours back to the unit and assist the unit with one of the ALA programs. Citizens assist the units with poppy distribution and placement of flags on veterans' graves. What an excellent way to teach our ALA Girl State citizens about veterans and the American Legion Auxiliary. I'm sure these volunteer opportunities remain in the hearts of ALA delegates long after their participation. 98 senators arrived for the 75th session of ALA Girls Nation. After a long day traveling, the senators were welcomed by staff and were ready to begin meeting their counterparts from other states. During the opening convocation, they learned about the American Legion Auxiliary poppy and then placed poppies in a wreath that was later placed at the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier. The Arlington National Cemetery tour included a tribute to veterans visiting the graves of former President John F. Kennedy and Supreme Court Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg, and viewing the changing of the guard at the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier. Throughout the week, ALA Girls Nation viewed a slideshow of pictures featuring special remembrances from the previous 74 years. The senators laughed at the various clothing styles and enjoyed the pictures from the various sessions. Our special project was the American Red Cross's Military and Caregiver Network. The senators and staff made thank you cards and packed 850 caregiver packages, including $4,250 worth of gift cards for distribution to caregivers for our veterans and military personnel. We were also given the opportunity to tour the American Red Cross's national headquarters. While touring the various DC monuments, National President Caffey placed a small bundle of poppies at the Korean War Memorial in memory of her father, a special moment for our national president. The senators enjoyed the twilight tattoo with reenactments of the Army's history through the eyes of the American soldier. Capitol Hill, where several were able to meet their real-life counterparts or their staff members, and an opportunity to tour the White House. While the trips were great additions to the program, the senators enjoyed debating their legislation and selecting their leaders for the week. The Senate discussed 10 bills, 2 Senate resolutions, and 2 Senate joint resolutions. 7 bills and 2 Senate resolutions were passed. Senator Marley English from Georgia was elected the ALA Girls Nation 75th president. The vice president was Ava Foley from Tennessee. And our outstanding senator was Sabrina Brandeis from California. Madam President, this concludes my platform remarks. However, may I introduce a special guest? It gives me great pleasure to introduce the 75th ALA Girls Nation President, Marley English. President English.
Good morning, everyone. As I said, I'm Marley English. I'm from Powder Springs, Georgia. First and foremost, I'd like to thank the American Legion Auxiliary for hosting Girls Nation. I'd like to thank Post 160 of Smyrna for sponsoring me, and I'd especially like to thank Georgia Girls State for supporting me the entire way and believing in me, because it's meant the most to me. Girls Nation is always described as one thing, a once-in-a-lifetime experience. And I used to think, like, of course it's a once-in-a-lifetime experience because you can only go once. But it wasn't until I attended that I understood what people really meant by once-in-a-lifetime. And so I had a lot of trouble writing my speech because I was like, you know, I don't really know how to describe it and really do it justice. Because you can explain what it literally is. It's a week-long program where two girls from each state are flown out to D.C. and they participate in mock Senate, they tour D.C., they meet their senators, so on and so forth. But that doesn't quite do the program justice. So I decided that the best way to explain it was maybe just to take it from the top. From the time I arrived to D.C., I met up with a group of girls from the airport. Coincidentally, the first senator I met was actually from Wisconsin, and I knew that I was going to be around the most supportive and brightest group of people that I would in my entire life. From the time we got onto the bus, we spoke to each other as if we had known each other for weeks. But we knew that we really only had a week. All of us had been to Girl State, and we knew how fast a week went by. So we started to get to know each other very quickly. And we started to learn from each other. And it was in the first hall meeting where we got asked, why were you interested in Girl State, and how did you get selected as a senator? And the answers would range from, my counselor signed me up from Girl State, to my mom had been, and I'd always wanted to go. And I think it was in that hall meeting that we understood that we really did come from all walks of life. It was probably the most diverse set of thought that I'd ever been around, because it wasn't just 50 states, it was 100 different perspectives, 100 different communities, 100 different people with different beliefs, and we had come together and we were able to discuss all of those and learn from each other. At the time, I didn't really know if I was gonna run for president because I don't have very many opportunities at home to do these public speaking, and the first time I'd ever run for anything was Girl State. So I was a little nervous, I was a little reserved. But I started to meet the girls and I realized that the best way to help your own community is to learn from other communities. And I realized that if I have 100 girls to speak to, well, that's 100 perspectives that may change. And I decided to weigh my options, which is something I like to do all the time. So the best case scenario was that I'd win and everything would be okay. And the worst case scenario was that I'd lose. But I thought if I lost and if I touched at least one person or changed one mind, then I'd go home feeling okay. I even did that with this speech. It was like the best case scenario is they all clap and they really like it. And the worst case scenario is I do terribly, but I'm pretty sure you guys wouldn't boo. So it's like, it'll be A-okay. At least I wouldn't know if they didn't like it. So at that time, I realized that I did want to become the president. I wanted to be able to talk to all the girls and I wanted to work with everyone, kind of step out of my comfort zone. So from there on, I went for it. And the first thing I had to do was get the party nomination. And I wrote a speech in one night and I just went for it. I gave my speech, I was so nervous. I remember taking the breath and thinking, I don't even know if words are gonna come out of my mouth right now. But while all of this was happening, I think that the most helpful thing was that I was still learning from everyone. As we went around DC, we talked to each other. I learned how to survive a bear attack from someone from Montana. And I also learned what the agricultural industry needs right now from Missouri. So it go from things that, I mean, I'm from the city in Georgia, so I don't quite know how to survive a bear attack. But it was a beautiful experience because when you say once in a lifetime, it's more like it creates once in a lifetime opportunities. That's the opportunity to learn things that you would have never learned without Girls Nation. And as I was going higher, so once I got my party nomination, I had to talk to everyone. And so everyone in my party made this amazing campaign using the Minions. And I had to talk with my vice president and we spoke for hours, making speeches, talking about beliefs. And I realized that, again, the worst case scenario is that you go home and you've changed a mind. Someone says, I'd never thought about it like that. And so I went to it, and I was obviously very nervous, but I was feeling okay because I knew that I had so many people supporting me. And I'm so grateful for all the girls there. They were the most amazing group of people ever. I went to the party rally and I gave a speech, and right after that was probably the most nerve-wracking part. It was whistle stops. I had to answer, I think it was about 50 questions, over the course of an hour, and I went to 15 different rooms. The questions would range from, like, what's your dream reality to what are you going to do to stop inflation? And so I was thinking all over the board, and that's what I think creates the once-in-a-lifetime opportunity of Girls Nation, is that you're forced to think all over the board. You're forced to think about issues that you would have never faced just sitting at home, and you're forced to get out of that echo chamber that's your community. I realize that if I want to advocate for things in my own community, because I really do prefer smaller scale community work, that I had to understand everything on a larger scale. And Girls Nation provided me that opportunity, and I'm so grateful for it always. A lot of people ask me about my future plans after Girls Nation, and I never really know what to say. I always want to say, well, I'll go to this college and major in this or have this career, but I don't have those answers yet. And so it reminds me of something that my mom does. She's sitting right there in the pink suit. She's what she likes to call a braggy mom, and that's kind of like, I like to think of it as if she sees a person take a breath in, by the time they take a breath out, they're going to know all the accolades of every single child she has. And she always tells me, like, Marley, why are you so humble? I brag on you all the time. And I think what it comes from is I believe that you don't, what you do isn't who you are. Who you are creates what you do. And I always hope that people notice that in me. I tell her, I think that if I just talk to people and get to know them, they're gonna figure out what I do. They're gonna figure out who I am. And that's what happened at Girls Nation. I was able to figure out who I am. And so when I think to my future, I think, oh, I think who I am will create what I do. I just have to keep going and keep hoping that I keep these opportunities. I mean, Girls Nation was an opportunity that I had never known about. It's a free chance to go to DC, meet 100 different people, and I look to the future and it gives me hope that we have so many youth who are passionate, who are driven, and who advocate for their community, but that we have programs like this where people, youth, are being supported. And I think all of us have felt a little hopeless seeing, you know, the world we're in. But I think that the only thing we can do is hold on to hope and keep moving forward, because I know that that's what I'll do. That's the only way that we can ever see any positive change. So at the end of the day, what Girls Nation provided to me was a newfound sense of hope and a solid backing that I know it'll be okay. And I know that there's a generation around me who's willing to work for it to be okay. And I want to thank everyone here for giving us the opportunity to do so. Thank you.
I had the pleasure of spending a week at Girls Nation. Every girl there was incredibly cool. Very, very proud that Marley was able to make it and join us here. Nancy, thank you for your report on our premier programs, and I'm really happy you got to meet Marley today. National Poppy Day recently gained media attention, and I was privileged to be a part of the movement focused on bringing awareness to our veterans and remembering soldiers we have lost in battle. Here to tell us more about the country, how the country embraced this day of awareness, is Sally Rossman, National Poppy Chairman.
Madam National President, our small red poppy produces a mighty thank you message to our national treasures, our veterans. There's no more fabulous treasure than those who gave of themselves for our freedoms. I have been honored to view the poppy representing our national treasures this year and how it has won my heart. And still in the legacy of the poppy in our youngest citizens gives root to the poppy programs likened the poppy seed sprouting. Members in the schools reading The Poppy Lady, explaining poppy history, gives our students a lasting foundation and appreciation for our veterans and their sacrifices. The introduction of the poppy history and the poppy poster contest to students creating the poppy will further explain honoring the veteran service to our country. Understanding why the poppy and our veterans are so important allows students to spread seeds of knowledge to peers and adults. Preschools to high school students created poppies, providing a wonderful introduction to the poppy. Preschoolers created paper poppies, while our high schoolers and elementary drew and painted poppies. Students, with the assistance of the auxiliary members, participated in colorful poppy poster contests, creating the most colorful posters. These posters can be seen in store windows, restaurants, and municipal buildings across this country. There was even a high school ceramics class that created 120 ceramic poppies for a memorial poppy field for a Legion family post home for Memorial Day. The support rods were donated by Gold Star father of First Lieutenant Ashley White. Senior members have enjoyed poppy painting parties across this great country, and poppy distribution and members branded attendance at patriotic and memorial events displayed our poppy, only growing the recognition program, much like the stem of the sea of the poppy reaching outward. Collaborating with other organizations allowed the auxiliary to leaf out, as does the poppy stem sprout leaves. The Outlet Resource Group reached out to the auxiliary for a second year for their 2022 Honoring the Brave poppy promotion at six of their outlet locations. Auxiliary members and outlet mall customer service encouraged shoppers to donate and save. Shoppers who donated to the American Legion Auxiliary received a poppy pin and a poppy savings card, and all donations came directly to the American Legion Auxiliary. The Outlet Resource Group provided all of the poppies and distribution materials purchased from the ALA National. Units participated in distributing poppies, telling the poppy story, and promoting the American Legion Auxiliary and Legion family membership. Utilizing poppy funds and a memorandum of understanding, the Department of Texas collaborated with the Armed Services YMCA to provide a $3,000 monthly donation for 10 months to fund food distributions at Fort Hood area beginning March of 2022. The first donation provided 476 bags with 15,980 pounds of food to reduce food insecurity among veterans and active duty personnel families. At each of the food bank events, a poppy display was presented with the American Legion contact information cards and an auxiliary thank you note placed in each bag. Additionally, Poppy Funds created a memorandum of understanding with the Canine for Warriors and the Department of Texas for a $25,000 donation to sponsor and train a service dog that the Department of Texas voted to name Poppy. The poppy plant's final culmination is a beautiful red poppy. So is the small red poppy of the American Legion Auxiliary. To ensure our communities recognize our national treasures, each veteran, members, and units met the National Poppy Challenge of a poppy in every veteran's window. Members were engaging the schools, youth organizations, churches, and Legion family members to allow children and adults to distribute a red poppy to be placed in the window of a veteran's home or in a business with a note provided by the auxiliary. This note thanked the veterans for their service and requested that the poppy be placed in their window. Red poppies are found across this great nation in numerous forms, however, always with the mission of acknowledging their sacrifices,
of our national treasures. This Poppy Challenge allowed citizens to recognize the sacrifice of our veterans and their families for the rights the citizens are granted today. The Red Memorial Poppy is a final remembrance of our veterans as they join their comrades in eternity. Members, juniors and seniors, place the red poppy at memorial services and cemeteries as a remembrance of their service to our country. Memorial Day finds many fields of red poppies and white crosses with red poppies to signify the greatness, loss of our treasures to our communities. Madam President, this concludes my platform remarks. May I introduce our 2022 Little Miss Poppy. Thank you. Introduce the 2022 National Little Miss Poppy, Allie Paige Haywood. Allie is a junior member of Haywood Veterans Memorial Unit 5 in Hammond, Louisiana.
Hello, I just would like to say it's been such an honor to be here, and thank you to Miss Kathy, the Auxiliary National President, and Miss Sally, the National Poppy Chairman, for inviting me to the National Convention. I'm a seventh grade student at Ponchatoula Junior High in Ponchatoula, Louisiana. I am a junior member of Unit 5. I was chosen Unit Little Miss Poppy in June 2021. Then in June 2022, I was chosen Department of Louisiana Little Miss Poppy. Then we got word that I was chosen to represent national organization. I have enjoyed helping my post and unit with their Poppy Day visiting schools with school supplies, giving out veggies to veterans at the VA clinic, and much more. Thank you again for this great opportunity to be here. I have a special gift for Miss Kathy, and Miss Sally. It is a Mardi Gras pin from Louisiana.
Oh my gosh, so many amazing young people. Thank you, Allie, and thank you, Sally. American Legion Auxiliary members. Are wonderful. From our grassroots members to our national leaders, we all work with the Americanism program. This year, I was able to see this program in action when I visited the Junior Shooting Sports Competition in Colorado. This year's competition was particularly exciting because the two champion spots were secured by women. The 2022 Precision Rifle Champion was awarded to McCole Hogan, and the Maria Menesis was awarded the champion spot in the Sporter category. Way to go, girls. It was really a proud moment to see them both receive their honors. Here to tell us more about how our members across the nation worked hand in hand to promote the Americanism program is National Chairman Norma Tram.
Americanism is a matter of the mind and heart. Americanism is not
and never was a matter of race and ancestry. A good American is one who is loyal to this country and to our creed of liberty and democracy. This is a quote from Franklin D. Roosevelt. National President Kathy, your focus this year has opened our eyes to the challenges of caregivers. Reading the Americanism essay winners, it was very evident that your focus rippled to the youth as well. The essay title was, How Can We Support Families Who Provide Care to Their Veterans? There are six classes for the contest. Class one is grade 3 and 4. Class 2 is 5 and 6. Class 3 is 7 and 8. 4 is 9 and 10. 5 is 11 and 12. And 6 is special needs students. I will read parts of some of the essays. Class 1, Kylie from Kentucky. I could give my neighbor Laura vegetables and go to the grocery store with my mom for more groceries. After I take my trash cans to the curb, I can go to Laura's house and take her trash out. I will do this every week. I will play with the kids. This would give Laura and Danny a needed break. I could also get the kids to take a nap. All little kids and caregivers need a nap. Danny is a veteran. He used to fly planes in the Navy. Danny got hurt, and Laura needs to help him every day. Laura needs support for Danny, and the help from me helps relieve their stress. I'm proud of the veterans who helped our freedoms. Class 6, grades 3 and 4, Tina from Wyoming. You can walk the dogs so they can be alone. This would help them relax. Another thought is you can make cards for them, birthday cards and Valentine cards and Christmas cards, because you can make them so happy. You can also write a thank you card for helping keep you safe and free. You can help by doing the Pledge of Allegiance. It helps you be good friends and reminds us of our freedoms. Class 3. Carolyn from Maryland. Developing a program to provide visits to veterans as well as pet visitations can help take stress off the family. Finding time to smile and laugh and forget about the everyday worries through socializing with each other can do wonders in supporting the family in their often daunting everyday task of veteran caregiving. Sometimes what we might think is nothing can be highly effective and helpful. Veterans and veterans' families deserve our time as a small way to say thank you for their service to our wonderful country. Class 3, Carmen from Montana. It's essential for families to take care of veterans who have someone there to talk to when things get tough. Sitting down with a family and merely engaging in a civilized conversation can make their day. Planning a potluck community get-together for all provides military families to get out of the house and interact with their community. The families give so much to their community, and it is time for the community to give back to them. Providing care to veterans is not an easy task. And as a proud citizen of America, it is my duty to support the family. Class 5, Aaron from South Dakota. It would be easy to say that citizens should just donate to the cause, but the truth is, money will only go so far. We can foster change by being proactive and educating youth about the troubles families of veterans face. I believe that in the classroom, support of veterans and their families should be reinforced as a civic duty. If the eyes of the ambitious youth of today are opened to the need of military families, they will go into the world as leaders, striving to make a difference for our veterans. Class 5. Hannah from Arizona. always reminding them that they don't have to be alone in this, and being able to receive help with hard or even simple things so they don't end up stressing out. Just remember, don't try to force them into wanting your help. They need to feel comfortable in the idea that you want to help them. Listen to the veterans tell their stories about their adventures. You might learn so many things from them. Overall, just be there for them when they need you. From the written word of our children, we gain knowledge. Thank you, President Kathy, for this appointment. This concludes my remarks.
Thank you, Norma. Our units and departments continually embrace our mission for education. To share with us their great accomplishments, please welcome National Education Chairman Melanie Taylor. Now I can read. Madam National President, the Dalai Lama once said, when educating the minds of our youth, we must not forget to educate their hearts. During another year of COVID-19, protocols were hampering the opportunities to be in the schools. Units were put to the test to find ways to promote the education program. Most departments reported their units were able to successfully participate in the Give 10 to Education program. The usual items of crayons, pens, pencils, notepads, erasers, and paper were delivered to the schools. But with this pandemic still going strong, hand sanitizers, cleaning supplies, masks, and sterile gloves were also requested and delivered. It wasn't difficult to collect the items and then deliver them to the classroom's front door. The Department of New York was challenged by the Department of North Carolina. This challenge was a two-part challenge, with the first part being most units participating in the Give 10 to Education program, and the second part was for the greatest number of national scholarships submitted from students in their departments. The winner of the challenge would be decided by a percentage of each part of the challenge and would end April 15th of 2022. New York and North Carolina held a conference call to determine who the winner was. New York won. New York's year-end results were 146 units gave $65,626 in school items to the Give 10 to the Education program. And $52,140 in unit scholarships were awarded. A total of 19 national and 110 department scholarship applications were submitted for consideration. What a great challenge for the units in these two departments to work the education program. Pleasantdale, Unit 354, Department of Nebraska, they sponsored a book drive for the Malcolm Public Elementary School Library as part of their Give 10 to the education program. Many books were given throughout the year. We the People, the United States Constitution, Explored and Explained by R. R. Lewis and Evan Sargent, Poppy Fields by Michael Morpurgo, Who Was a Veteran by Bernie Schwartz, and don't forget God Bless Our Troops by First Lady Dr. Jill Biden were just some of the books that were donated to the library. In March, the elementary school participated in the Dr. Seuss Read Across America. Unit 354 once again donated Dr. Seuss books for this event.
One member of the unit even took part in activities by reading a book to 7 different groups of students. The unit also honored and thanked the students at the Military and Veterans Success Center at the University of Nebraska-Lincoln with homemade cookies and purchased energy bars for Veterans Day. Signs were made welcoming them back and thanking them for their service. Pleasantdale Unit 354 definitely has a big heart for our children and veterans. Allied Unit 304, Department of California, has been working with a veteran from Vietnam era and his family for quite a few years. This past year, one of his sons passed away, leaving behind a wife and 4 children. I didn't think this was going to bother me as much. I'm sorry. Unit members stepped up to help this family, particularly the children, who had lost interest in everyday activities, including school. One of the children, Ethan, a 5th grade student, he was a smart boy, but very sad. Members of the unit took him aside and spoke with him, telling him to remember all the good memories of his father and to always keep him in his heart. He said he wanted to make his father proud, so he started taking interest in school again. With his wanting to learn, he excelled to the 10th grade level in school. At the end of the year graduation ceremony, Ethan received the President's Education Award in recognition of outstanding academic achievement, signed by Dr. Miguel A. Cardona, U.S. Secretary of Education, and Joseph R. Biden, Jr., the President of the United States. Because of this unit's caring heart and willingness to help, Ethan was able to achieve this award and said he felt his father would be proud of him. With 52 departments responding, I am pleased to report education was 100% reporting. Thank you all so very much. Nelson Mandela once said, "Education is the most powerful weapon which you can use to challenge the world." Madam President, this concludes my platform remarks.
Thank you so much, Melanie. American Legion Auxiliary members make it a priority to protect, care for, and support our veterans and military families and the children and youth. Here to share all the wonderful ways our departments and units use their own creativity and generosity to engage our children and youth is National Committee Chairman Trish Ward.
I can't stop them. I can't stop them. Nothing I can see but you when you dance, dance, dance. Feel the rhythm creeping up on you, so just dance, dance, dance. All those things I shouldn't do, but you dance, dance.
An unknown author said, "The greatest legacy we can leave our children is enough happiness to fill their hearts and more love than they can spend in a lifetime." And giving children happiness while filling their hearts with love is a core component of the American Legion Auxiliary mission. While caring and supporting military children is a key element of our program, caring for all children is our priority. While we were all enjoying Convention 2021 in Phoenix, trouble was looming just a few states away, and phones began ringing with a call to action. As Hurricane Ida was bearing down on Louisiana, members were assembling together and creating a plan for blasting the developing needs on social media. The storm was devastating for all, but especially for children in the Gulf. Baby formula was scarce and comfort items were at a premium. Within hours and from convention, ALA members stepped in a big way. Maine, West Virginia, New York, Puerto Rico, Colorado, California, and members and departments across the country followed with supplies on the way to our drop point in Baton Rouge. Thanks to our members, and within 24 hours, children in the Gulf had nutrition and supplies they desperately needed. Great job, team. We know that showing children respect and recognition positions them for a lifetime of success and service. The Children and Youth Program's Youth Hero, Good Deed, and Caregiver Recognition Awards enable every unit to make a difference in the life of a child and affirms the outstanding behavior and character of young people in their community. When it comes to our kids, our units do not disappoint. Let's hear it for E-Unit number 56 in the Department of Hawaii. Thanks to a quick-thinking Boy Scout on one of Hawaii's most treacherous trails, a stranded couple and their injured dog were helped and led to safety. Who knew that t-shirts could make a stretcher? It was special for everyone who witnessed National President Kathy present David King with the ALA Youth Hero Award on December 7th. Mahalo, Hawaii, for all you did to make this happen. With over 63 Youth Hero Awards and 254 Good Deed Awards this year, there's so much more to celebrate. ALA Good Deed Awards made sure that outstanding young people who gave of their time, talent, and fundraising treasure were recognized and appreciated. Our ALA Youth Caregiver Award honored National President Kathy's special focus of caregiving by recognizing the kind hearts and giving spirit of young caregivers. Young people raised money for care packages for cancer patients in Arkansas, helped special needs kids with sporting activities in Minnesota, and performed selfless acts of kindness across our country without expectation of payment. Thank you, American Legion Auxiliary Units, for all your great work recognizing the outstanding young caregivers in your community. We powered into the spring season with the month of the Military Child in April and Purple Up Day for military kids. Whether honoring military children with the table of the Military Child ceremony or just wearing purple to create awareness, members and units made sure that military kids were a focus. Bravo to American Legion Auxiliary District 28 in California, where lots of goodies and smiles were had by all. Well done, Golden Bear State, for brightening the day and lifting the hearts of military kids in Cali. Although the South Carolina Spartanburg County School District 2 is not near a military base, 79 of their students are part of a military family. Unit 200, Boiling Springs, went above and beyond gifting these special kids treat bags and certificates of appreciation. We are all so proud of our members and units who made recognizing military kids a priority, not only in April, but throughout the year. Let's not forget, last but not least, three cheers for Project Stuff Sack, our national children and youth project funded by an American Legion Child Welfare Foundation grant. Sacks and supplies were gifted to each of our 52 departments who jumped in and got busy. Members participated, donated, and organized events to make sure the supplies were put to good use. And who were the big winners? Our kids, of course. Just some of the distributed outlets included military children at Fort Riley in Kansas, a homeless shelter in Connecticut, Joy Junction Family Emergency Shelter in New Mexico, the Fisher House in Maryland, the children of recovering service members in Fort Belvoir, and so many more. This is a perfect example of how a Child Welfare Foundation grant gave us resources to work our mission, engage our members, and demonstrate how a small footprint of basic supplies can make a mighty impact in the lives of hundreds of children. Named one of the most influential educators for 2022, Gavin McCormick said, "The most beautiful thing in the world is a child's smile. The next best thing is that you are the reason behind it." American Legion Auxiliary members, your enthusiasm, your dedication and your tireless energy brought so many smiles to so many children. We urge you to continue your good work in support of our nation's children. Just know in your hearts that your passion for our mission and commitment to service has served to empower and inspire the next generation of leaders. Madam National President, it is now my great honor to introduce past National President Christine West, liaison to the Child Welfare Foundation.
Madam National President Kathy and Trish Ward, Children and Youth Committee Chairman, thank you for the kind introduction, and I might add, a wonderful, enthusiastic, and great leader Trish displayed as Chairman of Children and Youth Committee this year. Thanks to all the members of the committee promoting the Child Welfare Foundation. You worked tirelessly throughout the year, and results truly show a great increase in many departments. A special thank you to these ladies. I'd like to introduce the Children and Youth Chairman, Trish Ward, Paulette Karen, Vice Chairman, myself as a member, Deborah Lewis, Central Division Chairman, Lisa LaCourcier, Eastern Division Chairman, Tracy Trio, Northwestern Division Chairman, Sharon Atkins, Southern Division Chairman, and Teresa Montoya, Divisional Chairman. The annual Board of Directors meeting was held Sunday, October 3rd, 2021, in Indianapolis, that I was privileged to attend along with National President Kathy. At this meeting, 14 organizations were awarded a total of $639,000. Just think of that amount, $639,000, to help, assist, and lend a helping hand to children across America. All the organizations that received grants can be found on the American Legion Child Welfare Foundation website. However, I would like to mention just a few, beginning with our great organization, the American Legion Auxiliary, which included $3,390 for the special project Stuff a Stack. Thank you to Trish Ward for submitting this request. Also, the Auxiliary National Headquarters received $45,500 for the National Youth Scholarships, aiding us to give scholarships for Girls Nation, Children of Warriors, Spirit of Youth, Junior Member, and National President Scholarship. You can see how very important and necessary it is to donate to the Child Welfare Program. We are helping and assisting so many young people. Other notable organizations receiving awards were Adoption Exchange Association, based in Maryland. They received $22,780. Childhood Leukemia Foundation, based in New Jersey, $29,700. And the Children's Hospital in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, $30,000. As well as organizations in Connecticut that received $64,465,000, and New York-based organizations received a total of $36,300. Speaking of notable amounts, thanks and congratulations to the 29 departments who showed an increase in donations from last year. They are Alaska, Alabama, California, Connecticut, Delaware, Florida, Georgia, Iowa, Indiana, Kansas, Kentucky, Massachusetts, Maryland, Minnesota, Mississippi, New Jersey, New Mexico, New York, Ohio, Oklahoma, Pennsylvania, Puerto Rico, Rhode Island, South Carolina, Vermont, Washington, Wisconsin, West Virginia, and Wyoming. Total donations in 2021 from departments was $39,199. And for this year, ending May 31st, 2022, was $64,728. Wow, what a great accomplishment. Also, huge congratulations to the 18 departments that donated more than the American Legion. They are Arizona, Connecticut, Florida, Iowa, Illinois, Kentucky, Massachusetts, Maine, Minnesota, North Dakota, New Jersey, Oklahoma, Rhode Island, South Dakota, Tennessee, Utah, Vermont, and Wisconsin. Super great job, ladies, and thank you. Final totals for the year ending May 31st from the three organizations, the Sons of the American Legion, and the American Legion Auxiliary are: Sons of the American Legion, $349,789. The American Legion, $94,587. And the American Legion Auxiliary, $64,728. Great job to all. Please continue to support and promote the Child Welfare Foundation. Now it is my pleasure to welcome Peggy Moon, Vice President of the Child Welfare Foundation. Peggy Moon has been a member of Grissel Jacobson Post 560, Zimmerman, Minnesota, for 41 years, and was awarded a life membership by her post in 1997. She has served as commander, adjutant, chaplain, and was on the post honor guard. She served in the Air Force from 1971 to 1974. On the district level, Peggy served as commander, vice commander, public relations chairman, children and youth chairman, and currently serves as the commander's advisor. On the department level, Peggy has served as employment chairman, children and youth chairman. She served as membership chairman 2009 to 2010, and as department commander 2014-2015. She was recently elected as the alternate National Executive Committee man for Minnesota for the years 2019-2022. And will assume that position at the end of this convention. On the national level, she has served as vice president for the board of directors, the American Legion Child Welfare, and as vice chairman of Children and Youth Council. She and her husband, Carl, have been married for 45 years and have two daughters and six grandchildren, all members of the American Legion family. Please welcome Peggy Moon. Peggy.
Thank you for being a friend. Travel down a road and back again. Your heart is true, you're a pal and a confidant.
morning, fellow auxiliary members. I am thrilled to be here. I also, of course, have to give a shout out to the best state out there, Minnesota. Where are you? I have been a proud member of the American Legion Auxiliary since I was a young girl. I started out in the juniors. Yes, it's been a while because I'm obviously a senior now in more ways than one. And one of our newest members of our little auxiliary in Zimmerman, Minnesota is my husband, Carl. Yes. And right after he joined, they said, well, that's good. We're happy to have you. At our next meeting, we're having a pajama party. I have never seen him so fearful in my life. I want to thank you for all that you have done for the Child Welfare Foundation. As was mentioned earlier, we were able to raise $569,000 for this last year. And it is through the generous donations of all of your units that we make a difference in the lives of children all across this country. So my job here is to hand out awards. So we are going to start out with the Excellence Award, and it's given to the department with the highest per capita contribution average for the contribution year. And the winner of the Excellence Award is the Department of Kentucky. The next one is the Meritorious Achievement Award, and this goes to the department experiencing the highest increase in the per capita giving this past year. And once again, that is the Department of Kentucky. We also have the U.S. UDI Grant Legacy Award, and this goes to the top department nationally based on the combined total contributions of the American Legion Auxiliary, the Sons of the American Legion, and our Legion Riders, along with the 8 and 40. It's a lot of people, a lot of contributions. This award goes to the Department of Pennsylvania. And finally, we have the Garland Murphy Award. And this goes to the most active department in our nation based on the actual contributions received during the last contribution year. And this one goes to the Department of Florida. And with that, Madam President, I'd like to have you join me. I want to thank you and your auxiliary for everything you've done for the children of our nation. And to show you our thanks, we have this diamond American Legion Foundation pin for you. And I hope you will wear it with pride.
I will. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Let's move over to the pink and we'll get a picture.
Okay.
Madam National President, this concludes the platform remarks for the Children and Youth Program.
Thank you, Peggy, Trish, and Chris. What a great report. Let's continue with a few more Legion family guests. Michael Fox was elected National Commander of the Sons of the American Legion in Phoenix, Arizona, during their 49th National Convention. Commander Fox has been a member of the Sons of the American Legion Squadron 521 in Rio Linda, California, since the day he was born. He grew up in the organization alongside his father Ned and grandfather Ed, a World War II veteran. At the young age of five, Commander Fox volunteered at the local VA Medical Center, which helped him understand the service and sacrifice of veterans. At the old age of six, he held his first elected position at Squadron 521 as Sergeant at Arms. Please welcome our Sons of the American Legion National Commander, my good friend, Michael Fox.
Good morning. Hope everybody's having a wonderful morning. You know, as I'm sitting backstage and I'm watching those donations, it reminded me of how important the auxiliary is. Child Welfare Foundation, the Sons brought in almost $350,000. But that's because of you, and not snakes. You know, the American Legion Auxiliary is the true backbone and glue to the American Legion family. Everywhere I've traveled, yes. Everywhere I've traveled, the reason the Sons are able to raise that kind of money, to be involved so much, is because of the auxiliary. Because of you behind pushing them, participating with them, and for that I say thank you. When I was at convention last year and got elected, I asked for your help. I needed your help to accomplish our goals in the SAO. The Sons had an unprecedented year. The major project was flying flags for heroes. I set a goal to place 1 million flags, and I knew that the only way that the Sons would achieve that is with your help. Currently, we're 164,000 flags shy of reaching 2 million flags placed. And in all 40 detachments that I visited, every single one, the auxiliary was present. Thank you for being there to help us. I had the honor and privilege with traveling with Madam President, 10, 12, 15 times it seemed like we crossed paths. And it worked great because all three of us promoted the Legion family. Because the stronger the family unit is, the stronger that department is, the stronger that unit and squadron and post are. And I think we accomplished that goal. I appreciate everything you do for all of the squadrons, because they wouldn't survive without you. So please, don't give up on them, help them, continue to push them, continue to thrive, because always remember that when we work together, we're stronger. And there's no limit to the amount of good we can do, because we are the Legion family. We are Legion family strong. So God bless our veterans, God bless our military in harm's way, and God bless the United States. Nope, nope, nope. So, Madam President, this year was the 16th anniversary of the Legacy Run, and for the first time, we were all together. I brought a pin. Will you sign my helmet? And while the Madam President is signing my helmet, where's California at? Where's my ladies? Thank you. And second, my adopted family from Maryland, where are you at? Thank you so much for everything.
You can't sign that pass. This is a cool helmet, but show me the helmet.
Hello, everyone. I am Crystal Reagan. I'm Michael Fox's fiance. Thank you for welcoming me here, all of you ladies and gentlemen. If I can see any, thank you for welcoming us. We do have a gift to present to President Kathy. So she was there. We went to the poppy store in Normandy, and Normandy, right? Yes, okay. And she was looking at a whole bunch of poppy things, and she loved two purses. She bought one because she was trying not to spend too much money, and we silently picked up the second one for her. And I just want to mention that your president, our president, is one of the most amazing women I have ever met. She is strong. She has so much patriotism, so much love. And I can't explain how much I adore this woman. She exemplifies everything that the Legion stands for. And I hope that you feel, just as I feel, that she's represented this organization with the utmost pride, love, and devotion.
And I love the snake.
Hey, you forgot your snake. So Michael was given a road name on the Legacy Ride. His road name is Snake. You have to ask him about the story. All right. Joining me next is Commander Paul Dillard, the leader of the nation's largest veterans organization. He was elected National Commander of the American Legion in Indianapolis during the organization's 102nd National Convention in Phoenix, Arizona. Commander Dillard first joined the Legion in 1969 and served in several post and national leadership positions before being elected National Vice Commander in 2013. Commander Dillard's theme, No Veteran Left Behind, paired perfectly with my focus on caregivers. Together, we sent a clear message that the Legion family's primary concern is to ensure all veterans receive the support and care they need. Please welcome our national commander, my favorite current national commander, and my really good friend, Paul Dillard.
Howdy, folks. I can promise you one thing. Of course, normally when you're all these lights, you can't really see too much out there. but this is a whole lot better looking crowd than what I'm going to be looking at for 2 days. And as I was coming up the sidewall, I smelled a lot better too. So thank you for having me. You're lucky, Madam President kind of shot me in here at this time because I got another one I got to be at in a little bit, so I can't talk too long. Normally I want 45 minutes, but they tell me it's just 4 or 5 minutes. But being from Texas, as you've heard me say this year, I can take a 4 or 5 minute speech and make it 45. So it doesn't really matter. But before I start bragging on this lady that I've had the opportunity to serve with this year, I want to thank each and every one of you that responded to our legislative alerts to pass the PACT Act. I don't know if you really realize the magnitude of that. You know, it's going to affect over 3.5 million veterans over several generations, and it's going to change thousands of lives. Especially those on the burn pits where they had been denied. Over 70 or 80% of them had been denied benefits because they said it wasn't service connected. Well, now we have 28 presumptive conditions, and they will get the benefits that they so rightly earned. And thank you. However, I'm putting out another big call for our family organization. In the American Legion magazine this month, right in the middle fold, was a QR code. I don't know if y'all got one, but if not, steal one of those. And try to, you can get one or get it from Media Communication Marketing there in National. Put that on your website. Instead of people have to go to legion.org and go to legislative and go here or there to get signed up for the alerts, you can just take your smartphone and get a smart person to do it. And you can be on it just like that. Where we had, you know, in the upper 30, 34, 35,000 people respond to those. It's so simple because you punch in your zip code, you punch this, and boom, it's gone. The senators was very surprised, and this just went to senators I was working on because it passed the House, but they were surprised when they got in excess of 35,000. But what would have happened if we'd had a quarter of a million? 100,000. We aren't to be able to grow that to 500,000 when we have an issue or a bill we need passed. Because, folks, we will have more battles to fight. And with your help, and get this out, even take copies of it and pass around at your meetings, post meetings, or unit meetings, or what have you, and get people signed up because that makes our voice much, much louder. And we'd appreciate your help on that. So now, this lady I served with, what's her name? Oh. Y'all did well. I got lucky by serving with this lady. But you always do a good job selecting your presidents and bringing them up. But I'll be honest with you, I have enjoyed working with Kathy this year. I know many other presidents have done a fantastic job. Well, my mother-in-law was one of them, so I guess I better say that, hadn't I? I'd be getting in trouble. And, of course, Carlene from Texas, she'd get me in trouble, too. But, no, you have. You always do a good job, and the knowledge is so much there. But, you know, I had a lot of fun with Kathy. I always picked on her. She's always got that big smile, you know. And so it has been magnificent, you know, to serve with her. I believe other than Europe and Hawaii, we probably was only together 2 or 3 times. Because she had taken care of her business, I'd taken care of our business. But it's been a pleasure. And I'm going to close here. I got a little trinket kind of to give her. And I want to wish y'all a very, very, very remaining convention. Have a good time here in Milwaukee. And as I've told many of my commissions in committees I went to and NEC the pre-convention this morning, be safe. Be safe going home because your membership counts. So be safe going home, okay? But God bless each and every one of you. God bless our men and women serving in uniform, and God bless this United States of America. Madam President.
Oh, here, that's yours.
Oh, I thought you were going to open it.
It's a boo-boo prize.
A boo-boo prize?
Boo-boo prize.
Boo-boo prize.
See? See?
You're awful.
I'm terrible. What is it? Just an empty pack?
He doesn't even know what it is.
I do, too. I do, too. It's an empty box. Just don't know how long and hard I looked to find that.
Beautiful.
You really don't.
I can't see it. I know. I believe you. Donna did it, didn't she?
No.
Oh.
No, she didn't.
She didn't.
Well, my lips are moving up. Thank you, dear.
Thank you.
I'll
so
let
much.
You go. Thank you.
Y'all,
huh? Oh. Really? We got to do this. Roses in the middle, thorns on each side.
So he didn't tell her or introduce her, but his wife is Donna Dillard. I already knew that. I also, wait, Walter, where are you going? Walter, come back here, Walter. Come here for 1 second. You, come here for 1 second, please. Walter Ivy is Commander Dillard's aide, and he loves me.
What?
So much so that when we were in Hawaii, every time he got out of the van, he left me in the back seat and locked all the doors. More than once.
I volunteer to sit back there.
So, Walter, I have a special little gift for you.
Oh.
You can open that later.
Okay. Oh, miss later. No, this right now. Okay. What do we got? Oh.
I keep trying to bribe him with sweets, but he still locked me in the van.
Okay.
So you can open that later. Let's get a quick picture with you.
Okay.
You'll see more of Paul on Wednesday night as he is the state's dinner MC. All right, let's continue with a few more Legion family guests. It is my pleasure to introduce the 2022 Convention Corporation President, Ted DiMicci.
Well, good morning. Good morning to the Wisconsin delegation that's out there. What an honor it is to be here in front of you to welcome you to Milwaukee, Wisconsin. Not only that, but they have allowed me to follow the commander of the SAL, the commander of the American Legion, and now expect me to speak with them speaking before me. Unreal. But anyway, as you know, years ago, we had to deviate from Louisville, we had no convention. Last year we were out in Phoenix. We had sort of a minor glitches there, what they did for us. This time here in Milwaukee, the city is wide open to each and every one of you. Go to the restaurants, go to the exhibits, go see the museums, go to Harley-Davidson, go to Mater's, probably one of the best German restaurants you'll ever go into, and you don't have to wear a mask anywhere if you don't want to, which is fantastic. Madam President, thank you very much for bringing your congregation here to the city of Milwaukee. We open up our arms to you. If you have any questions, if you have any place you'd like to go see, make sure you see one of the people from the Department of Wisconsin here with the auxiliary, and also any person with their cap on that says Wisconsin, stop them, say hello, get greetings from them, and ask them questions. That's what we're here for, is to help you to have yourself a great stay here in Milwaukee until Wednesday until Wednesday night. So again, I will see you Wednesday night again, so thank you very much for allowing me to speak to you. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Can we get a picture?
Sure. Oh, by the way, when I had to pin your national president the other day, I was very nervous because she had a nice vest on and everything, and I just asked her if she would kind of pull her vest away a little bit so I could put my hand in there to do it. So. And I asked her, don't smile a lot either, because they're taking pictures.
Thank you so much, Ted. Through leadership, you will plant the seeds of success and growth will continue. That was the goal of the leadership committee, and they were able to achieve great results. For more information, please welcome National Leadership Chairman, Brenda Collins.
Leadership training was conducted across this great land. Divisions worked with the departments, districts, units to promote the leadership program. In the Central Division, Indiana concentrated on three areas of the leadership program: nurturing a culture of goodwill, mentoring, and the ALA Academy, and they had a successful year. The Eastern Division saw New York recognizing their members who had taken the leadership test, and they had several leadership workshops at their fall conference. Colorado prepares their leaders in the Northwestern Division, that's true, by educating, engaging, and empowering their members. Idaho reported that their department leadership training at their department convention had several topics, some of which were planning for success and setting an example. Numerous department leadership chairmen put together survival leadership kits. In the Southern Division, South Carolina put one together for junior members. They replaced the rubber band with a stress ball, hopefully to reduce accidents. The leadership survival kits are a rubber band to always remind you to be flexible, a paper clip to hold your reports and your volunteer hours together, an eraser to remind you that your mistakes are never permanent, bubble gum to remind you that the child within you is important, crayons to inspire you to go out and color the world. Smarties, to remind you that you are smart and you make good decisions. Post-it notes to keep communications flowing. Quotes that inspire leaders within. Snickers bars to keep you laughing. Pencils to write down all those good ideas. And a Band-Aid to remind you to heal problems and hard feelings. Stars to remind you that that's what you're reaching for. These clever leadership survival kits have been great tools to promote the leadership skills throughout the auxiliary. In conclusion, here is a great quote to always keep in mind. Leadership is an action, not a position. Thank you, President Cathy, for your confidence in me.
Thank you, Brenda. Strengthening our communities is something American Legion Auxiliary members strive for every day. It's why we all operate under the motto, service, not self. Please welcome Denise Conrad, National Community Service Chairman, to tell us more about how our members contributed to our communities.
Good morning, Madam President, Cathy, and good morning to all. Community service looks a little bit different in every community. It's based on the needs of that particular community, but the common thread of all is serving our communities, and it remains the same. Supporting our local food pantries is at the heart of it all. In Tampa, Florida, a food drive was held at Childs Elementary School. And in Arizona, the Post 91 Legion family came together to support their local food pantries, and wow, did they make an impact. Nebraska and many other departments did a Stuff the Truck food pantry project at their local school or community events. Communities were also encouraged to remember our furry friends when donating. In New Hampshire, using a colored lit tree, members of the community could donate in honor of a loved one. The colored light would then be exchanged for a white one, and all the proceeds would go to the local food pantry. Beautification of our roadways, trails, community centers, and parks were another way that we care for our communities. In Delaware and Minnesota, flowers were planted around the community buildings and parks. And roadways were adopted to keep America beautiful. Units spearheaded fundraising to build and refurbish playground equipment. For some extra summer fun, Unit 289 in Strasburg, Illinois, painted games on the school blacktop, with permission, of course. First responders were recognized in communities with projects like Coffee for Cops in Tennessee, or Baked Goods for Badges, and Angel Bakery Day in other parts of the nation. Unit 421 in Ohio had gifts and goodies to say thank you to our first responders, including key rings and sweet treats, and Ohio also spearheaded a project for the memorial of a fallen police officer. Many of the country's best cooks prepared school meals for athletes, for funeral dinners, for life celebrations, for first responders during a crisis event, and for monthly or weekly meals for the underprivileged or underserved members of our community. Some units did a carryout meal, like Unit 44 in New Mexico, who assembled picnic bags that would feed a family of four, and it had all the fixings: burgers, dogs, buns, chips, beans, fruit cups, and a poppy coloring book, and an American flag. They were delivered to the needy families that were identified by the local schools. Caring for others is a selfless act. Our members in Michigan, District 2, came together to provide goodie bags for the caregiver spouses who accompanied their veteran to the Will Win Lodge Retreat Center for Therapy. South Dakota units had to help to support the Northern Hills Training Center. It's a residential services whose goal is to identify the specific type of housing that's needed for a community member and then find a place that's a good fit for that person. Another great project was taken on by California, District 18. They have a great relationship with Fort Irwin Military Base, and Fort Irwin reached out saying they needed new books for their library. Their library not only serves the military children and adults on the base, but the entire surrounding underprivileged area. So a list of books that was needed was sent to the district by Fort Irwin, and they responded by hitting the bricks with email and social networking, and the funding came in from around the country. They were able to purchase 1,031 new books for the Fort Irwin Library. Way to go, California. However, the largest project that happened this year was Unit 127 in Gladbrook, Iowa, who is busy all year round. They do a kids' shopping day for Christmas. Between 200 and 250 students of area elementary and preschools come to shop for their family, and all the gifts are free to the student shopper. The gifts, one gift per person, and they're allowed 10 people on their list, but no gift for themselves. Preschoolers are helped by an adult who is not a list on their shopping list. Communities from around the area and other organizations within the communities are solicited for items. Each gift is wrapped, and a tag signed by the child is attached to each gift that they choose. Most parents say it is the best gift they get for Christmas. It takes 80 volunteers the day of the event and countless hours and volunteers in preparation. Before leaving the event, each child must visit the People of Bethlehem, where they receive a nativity card and a gift from the unit. It's usually a craft or an ornament. This December will mark the 10th year for this outstanding event. Hats off to Gladbrook. These are just a few of the outstanding projects our units participated in this past year. Wear your ALA clothing with pride when you are caring for others in your communities in service, not self. I'd like to extend a special thanks to all my community service division chairmen and their department teams for their service this past year, especially to our vice chairman, Marty Peters, for all their help. Madam President Kathy, this concludes my community service report, and thank you so much for this appointment.
Thank you, Denise. For a veteran, coming home is the beginning of a new journey, a transition to find a new normal. Here to tell us more about how our members use their caring hearts to comfort and care for veterans during this transition is our National Veterans Affairs and Rehabilitation Chairman, Lisa Williamson.
Good morning. Audrey Hepburn once said, "You have two hands, one to help yourself and one to help others." What she failed to mention was the caring heart. And I can tell you that our American Legion Auxiliary members have heart, the biggest of caring hearts, and have readily embraced National President Kathy Dottestal's focus, caring for those who care for others. Every department came up with some way to remember caregivers, but let's showcase a few. In conjunction with President Kathy's visit to Maine, she was delighted to honor some caregivers at a special luncheon. After each caregiver's story was told, she greeted them with a hug and spent a few special moments with each. Each received a certificate and a gift bag. Members in Texas handed out 510 Proud Home of a Veteran and Proud Home of a Veteran Caregiver cards to be placed in windows of veterans' homes. To go one further, El Paso Unit 36 made 100 large thank you to our veteran signs and placed them in their yards. As well, visiting with these veterans and their caregivers while thanking them proved to be a wonderful membership recruitment opportunity. Even President Kathy's Department of Kentucky reported teaming up with another department to supply caregiver bags to caregivers at the local VA. So let's switch gears a bit. Co-presented by the Department of Veterans Affairs and the American Legion Auxiliary, the National Veteran Creative Arts Festival is the culmination of talent competitions in art, creative writing, dance, drama, and music for veterans treated in the VA healthcare system. How did they get selected, you might ask? It starts at your local VA. Local VA creative arts winning entries advance to the national judging process where winners are determined each category. But shockingly, not every VA participates. But what can you do to change this? Start small. Plant the seed. Try a smaller event to see if it can gain some momentum. The Department of Idaho did just that. Their VNR chairman started bringing art supplies to the state veterans' home in Boise. The veterans created artwork that was eventually displayed during Iowa's Department Midwinter Conference for their very first arts and crafts show. It started with a vision. Who knows where it will lead? But let's hope these veteran artists enter their creations into the Boise VA Medical Center and possibly continue on to the national event. National Vice President Vicki Kautz's Department of Indiana took a vision and started a local creative arts festival and executed it with caring hearts. Martinsville Unit 230 organized and hosted the first Morgan County Veteran Arts Festival. 18 pieces of artwork were submitted for competition. This festival was advertised and publicized through social media, local newspapers, flyers, and even interviews on the radio and television. I'll pause here for a second to let you look at some of the artwork. Boise did have an entry this year in St. Petersburg, but wouldn't it be great, a wonderful opportunity to grow? And now that Indiana has their first one under their belt, I hope they will partner with one of their VA facilities, allowing these artists the opportunity to participate in the national event during April 10th through the 17th, 2023 in St. Louis, Missouri. I recommend both these departments and any other department that are considering a local VCAF to consider applying for the ALA Foundation grant. Grants can be awarded up to $2,500, and it's very quite simple. One more thing. If you have never been to a National Veterans Creates for Arts Festival, I highly recommend it. Our VNR committee was there the entire week, along with President Kathy and National Vice President Vicki, and I know every single one of us would say it's exhausting, but oh so rewarding. In closing, I'd like to leave you with something Muhammad Ali said. Service to others is the rent you pay for your room here on earth. And our members, especially our caregivers, have paid in full. Madam National President, this concludes the platform remarks for the Veterans Affairs and Rehabilitation Committee.
Thank you for your report, Lisa. Hey,
hey.
You know why you're still up here? Let's recognize these departments that work so hard to raise money for the National Veterans Creative Arts Festival.
Let's do it.
Take a look at our gold, silver, and bronze donor departments.
You can read gold, I'll read the next. And then...
The gold, the Department of California, the Department of Wisconsin, the Department of Texas, the Department of Ohio, Department of Connecticut, and the Department of Maryland. Department of New York, I skipped over one.
The silver, Department of Iowa, Department of Illinois, and Department of South Dakota.
And the bronze, the Department of New Hampshire, Kansas, Florida, Nebraska, Delaware, Arizona, New Jersey, Minnesota, and Massachusetts.
Love you.
Whew. Awesome. And I double agree with her. If you have not been to a Veterans Creative Arts Festival, put it on your list. It's well worth it. We have just one more item of business before we adjourn for the day. I know, right? Before we do that, would our National Secretary Coral come back to the podium with today's convention updates? She's right behind me.
First of all, if you are a 2022-2023 department president, please remain in the convention hall for a brief meeting regarding the instructions for installation. Don't forget to visit the Giving Tuesday booth and show your support to our nation's heroes. The booth is conveniently located and open before and after each session, so don't delay, donate today. We have a recognition this morning. In the audience, we have a 91-year-old member celebrating her birthday today. Her name is Marion Woodcock from the Department of Massachusetts, the Unit Member of the Year. And finally, yes?
I say we sing happy birthday to Mary.
Okay.
Where is Mary?
Where are you, Marion? Up there.
You ready?
Ready? Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Marion. Happy birthday to you. And finally, it's time for you to place your bids at the ALA Foundation's silent auction. All items are online now and will be available to view at the state's dinner. Bidding will close on Wednesday. Place your bids, ladies. Madam President, that concludes the updates. We're ready for your last piece of business.
All right. Well, right before we get into that, I just want to shout out to someone. You heard that the National Commander, the National Sons of the American Legion Commander, and myself rode in the Legacy Ride this year. But I also want to give a shout out to one of my National Vice Presidents, Division Vice Presidents, Gabriel Barnett, who also rode in the ride on her own bike. All right, are you ready for the last piece of business? With so many wonderful, inspirational ideas, our membership committee went above and beyond to enhance membership strength. To give us more insight into this program, please welcome our National Membership Chairman, Michelle DeGennaro.
Thank you, Madam President. And thank you, the members. Good morning. As the membership team prepared for the year ahead, we knew we wanted to excite and rejuvenate our members. Facebook postings and Zoom meetings set the tone, and the message was heard. It was time to have fun, be kind, all while working our mission, and the members will join. And join they did. As we continue to push towards our national goal, units, districts, and departments increased membership for the first time in years. We had 20 new charters, 21 recharters, 212 winners for the 10 new in 2022 award, and 27 departments that won the 95% award. And in very exciting news, we had 21 departments reach their goal of 100% or better. Wow, a big woo-hoo to you. The Department of Alabama, the Department of Alaska, the Department of Arizona, the Department of California, the Department of Delaware, the Department of District of Columbia, the Department of Florida, the Department of Hawaii, the Department of Maryland, the Department of Massachusetts, the Department of Michigan, the Department of Mississippi, the Department of New Mexico, the Department of North Carolina, the Department of Oregon, the Department of Pennsylvania, the Department of Puerto Rico, the Department of South Carolina, the Department of Tennessee, Department of Texas, and the Department of Virginia. Let's hear it again for these 21 departments. The Department of New Mexico had their taste of first place, and they refused to let it go as they continued to climb in membership week after week. Some of their success they attribute to the heartfelt gesture of Duran Y. Gallegos, Unit 69. When one of their members looked through their unit roster and paid 7 members' dues as a way to pay it forward. Units held membership drives and early bird dinner renewals. Units also used Facebook, local radio stations, newspapers, and other media sources to get the word out about the American Legion Auxiliary. Way to go, Department of New Mexico. The Southern Division came to the party, and they wanted everyone to know as department after department reached goal. Congratulations, Southern Division. St. Cloud Unit 80 in the Department of Florida held several membership drives, but their most popular one was their Friends themed. It was the brainchild of dual SAL and auxiliary member Sean Laberty. With the help of fellow Legion family members, the post canteen was turned into the Central Park Cafe. Flyers were distributed, and the event was promoted on Facebook and in the St. Cloud Historic Downtown paper. The evening proved to be a big success when they signed up 4 Legionnaires, 4 auxiliary members, and 5 SAL members. Several other applications went out as well, all with the promise of returning with the proper paperwork. The membership drive was such a big hit, they'll be doing membership drives just like this one with different themes on a quarterly basis. District President Marla Musselman from the Department of South Dakota wanted in on the action too, as she rounded up her team for a phone-a-thon. With rosters in hand, phone calls were made, reaching out to lost and forgotten members just to let them know they cared. On Veterans Day, the Department of Illinois showed what the American Legion family was all about at the Illinois State Fair. They talked to potential members about their why and the reason for joining, then asked them to talk about the special veteran in their lives. They explained how membership honored the service of these members. The Department of Connecticut brought the magic to their membership as they worked together with Legion families from Connecticut, Massachusetts, and New Hampshire to promote revitalization. Legionnaires and auxiliary members manned the membership table at a two-day apple harvest fair to promote awareness of our organization and invite attendees to join. The Department of Texas membership team, led by past national president Carlene Ashworth, met members in units that were struggling. They helped them plan activities to work the programs that would encourage, motivate, and inspire members and get the community involved. The department president's membership theme was put into action, growing our membership by cultivating kindness. And the membership committee came up with the catchphrase, "Who do you know?" Who do you know that has not paid their dues? Who do you know that is eligible to join but has not been asked to join? Who do you know in your family that is eligible but has never been offered an application? Who do you know that is a former member and hasn't paid their dues for a few years? Buttons were made with this phrase and a beautiful bouquet of sunflowers in the forefront to carry out the president's theme. These buttons were distributed across the state as they encouraged members to wear them everywhere so people would ask, what do the buttons mean? And open the conversation to talk about the American Legion Auxiliary family. All our departments did such an amazing job this year. I would like to take this time to thank the awesome national membership team for all their hard work and dedication, countless Zoom meetings, emails and phone calls, hundreds of Facebook postings, and by the way, the numbers have been posted this morning for close of books, so check your Facebook, and many, many thank you cards. It takes a village. And from the bottom of my heart, I thank you, the members. We can't do what we do without each and every one of you, so thank you. Madam President, this concludes my platform remarks. Woohoo! Sorry.
Oh, you're fine.
Woohoo?
Woohoo?
Michelle, I love your enthusiasm, but woohoo?
Woohoo!
It's just not going to cut it. Not with 21 departments reaching 100% goal. It goes to show you we're better together. We might still have a long way to go to ensure we're able to continue our mission of service, but that doesn't mean we can't celebrate the achievements along the way. So everyone, grab your light sticks. Whoops. Don't hit your neighbor. Light them up and let's make some noise.
Woo-hoo!
Would the 21 department presidents please stand up and let's hit it, JP.
Because we're better together, stronger side by side. This is a moment, it's our time. So we're different, whatever.
Woo! Stay up there.
All right.
All right, let's count down to an even better membership year in 2023. Here we go. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Woo! Woohoo, that's awesome. Great job. What an incredible, great opening session. You guys are amazing. So please be sure to take some Gillette caregiver razors on your way out. These razors have been specially created and designed for caregivers who shave others. Fantastic. Gillette found out that it was the ALA focus this year and donated 2,000 caregiver razors. And we are passing them on to you. Thank you, everyone. I'll see you all tomorrow at session 2 at 8:30 a.m. We are adjourned. Yeah.